Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we're studying the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this series of lessons is for the first 3 months of 2014. It's a series entitled Discipleship. And this particular lesson is lesson number 9 in that series entitled Discipling the Powerful. It's the lesson for March 1 of 2014. We prepare handouts for our studies together, and of course the discussion is not controlled by the handout, as you no doubt know. But if you would find some of this material useful in your own case, for your Sabbath school class, or for whatever reason, just for personal study, those handouts are available on our website at theox, that's theox.org. We hope you enjoy our time together as we do. But before we start, let's begin with a word of prayer. Our loving Father, we thank you for this time to open the Word, to consider your thoughts after you, to think about the challenges that Jesus and the disciples and the other apostles faced as they dealt with the religious leaders of their day. And not only that, the political leaders, people in powerful positions, even Roman centurions. Help us to learn what we can learn from this experience, and perhaps someday benefit by being better able to relate to those in positions of power in our day, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Political and religious power. And isn't there something about keeping religious power and political power separate? We Americans have said that we bask in the first government to mandate that religious and political power be kept separate. Is that a good thing or not a good thing? Or
well, the origins of our country come out of a historical past where the church kind of mingled and interfered in government affairs, and the government had a tendency to mingle in church affairs, and
exactly,
it created all kinds of problems for everybody. And so that's kind of why in this country we kind of like what we call this wall between separation of church and state.
Good. Can you imagine what it would be like to have been a member of the Sanhedrin? Remember, the Sanhedrin is made up of Sadducees and Pharisees, and they were at each other's throats much of the time. But during that period from AD 27, when Jesus was baptized, until AD 34, when finally Stephen was stoned and they began to persecute Christians and Christians just scattered, think about what it would have been like to be on the other side, to be a member of the Sanhedrin during that time. How do you think you would have related to this upstart organization that we now call Christianity?
I'm sure they found it threatening to the status quo.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we know that later some of the priests actually were converted. Doesn't say exactly what strata of priesthood, but it must have given some of the Sanhedrin cause for reflection.
But look at a couple of verses in light of what you've just said. Look at Acts, the book of Acts. Go to chapter 6. And there's an interesting and provocative
verse 7.
And so the word of God continued to spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem grew larger and larger, and a great number of priests accepted the faith. Now, which group were largely composed of priests?
Sadducees.
Because remember, Paul was a member of the Pharisees. He was a member of the Sanhedrin. He was a Pharisee. What tribe did he belong to?
Benjamin.
He was from the tribe of Benjamin. He couldn't be a priest. The Pharisees came from a variety of tribes. So now,
the Levi heritage had kind of fallen apart here.
No, it was still, I mean, some people thought it was important. Not everybody thought it was important, but some people thought it was important. And so we'll just say that it sounds here like maybe some Sadducees actually became Christians. Now look at Acts 15, verse 5. I mean, this is the leading up to the great discussion, the first general conference session in Acts 15. But some of the believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees stood up and said the Gentiles must be circumcised and told to obey the law of Moses. So here's some Pharisees who had become Christians that hadn't apparently given up all their Pharisaical ways. So it looks like, unless I've misjudged here, that both Sadducees and Pharisees became Christians.
So we shouldn't necessarily, quote, give up, end quote, on someone who doesn't seem to believe what we consider the truth?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There's still hope?
Still hope. Paul had some very interesting words to say about the relation Christians should take toward governments. They're found in Romans 13, the first seven verses. I think we probably should read all seven of those verses. Everyone must obey the state authorities. I'm reading from my Good News Bible. Because no authority exists without God's permission. And the existing authorities have been put there by God. Now, immediately, some of you are going to be thinking about Hitler and Stalin and Idi Amin and people of that type. Were they put there by God? Well, whoever opposes the existing, I mean, what about Nero, who ended up finally chopping Paul's head off? Do you think he would have said these words about Nero?
To the extent that nothing happens without God allowing it, mm-hmm. he put them there. It may not have been his will to put any of them there.
Well, like, he put Saul in, yeah. the first king.
Yeah.
Because Israel insisted on it.
Mm-hmm. Well, Paul goes on to say, whoever opposes the existing authority opposes what God has ordered. And anyone who does so will bring judgment on himself. For rulers are not to be feared by those who do good, but by those who do evil. Would you like to be unafraid of those in authority?
Is Paul talking about divine judgment or secular judgment here?
I think he's talking about secular judgment. I don't know, someone have some
In other words, if you buck the system here, you're just asking for trouble. That's kind of what he's saying.
Some of this might be somewhat politically correct. He knew the times he was living in. He knew what was coming down the pike, and he wasn't going to speed it up.
Yeah.
Doesn't he almost infer there's another side at the end of 7? If you look down, it says, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. In other words, if they're jerks, you don't really owe them anything.
Yeah. Let me read the couple of verses in between there. But if you do, because they are God's servants working for your own good, he says. But if you do evil, then be afraid of them, because their power to punish is real. Paul found that out, didn't he? They are God's servants and carry out God's punishment on those who do evil. For this reason, you must obey the authorities, not just because of God's punishment, but also as a matter of conscience. In other words, you're supposed to do right for what reason?
Because it is right.
Do right because it is right.
So how is this going to disciple these powerful
enemies? Well, at least you're not going to antagonize them by breaking the law, right? As far as possible. That is also why we pay taxes, he goes on, because the authorities are working for God when they fulfill their duties. Pay then what you owe them, pay them your personal property taxes, and show respect and honor for them all. As Gary has already pointed out, to those to whom it's due, mm-hmm. right? Well, what was Paul's relationship to the Roman government?
He was a citizen. Yeah.
He was a citizen? And sometimes that protected him, didn't it?
Yes, it did.
Other times, it wasn't so good.
And he used the protection, too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And is there something to be learned from that? We should take advantage of the protections and the whatever that, I mean, we're paying our taxes. We should take advantage of the protections which are afforded us as normal citizens. We shouldn't, you know, abuse those privileges, but we should take advantage of them, right?
I just wonder how many rumors are going around that time that these Christians are working against the government. They're working against the people, you know, the... Mm-hmm. the thing to try to get people stirred up about them. And then Paul just kind of pours pours it on the other direction mm-hmm. to try to demonstrate that that's not true.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe it wasn't entirely rumors. Maybe there were some Christians who felt that they had the right to, I don't know, pound their religion into other people or something.
Yeah.
But his word also implied that the government is doing the right thing, that you're obeying and doing what's right. But what do you do when the government is corrupt and mean and evil? And
mm-hmm. Which is the way we generally, we portray the government of Rome. It was ruthless. It was iron-fisted. They operated on slavery. You know, if they needed mm-hmm. soldiers, they'd just knock you over the head and put you in a suit of armor and say, you're going with us.
Well, at all times, Paul suggests, the church was or is supposed to be separate and distinct from government authority. But today we see more and more interaction between church and state. Even in our country, where there's supposed to be that, you know, ironclad wall.
Wait, what time was there ever in history where there was a separation of church and state before the United States?
No.
There wasn't?
No.
So, what's the big point of this?
Separating church and state?
Yeah.
Well, look what's happened the last couple hundred years in the United States. It's been a tremendous blessing for us.
Well,
why do you think all the people who came from Europe came here? All the ones in the early days came here because of religious persecution. Because they were under governments that were controlled
by... Well, I guess what I'm saying is that you're kind of defining that as a truth that wasn't really there for most of the history of the earth.
I mean,
religion and government was the same.
Also one of the same.
It was one of the same the whole time, except for the time the United States was here. And that was basically because the states were all different types of religion, and the federal government was trying to get them together to unite together to make the United States. And to do that, they had to come up with freedom of religion.
Yeah.
Because it just wouldn't have happened. Yeah. So this is kind of a unique thing.
Yeah, and it was an attempt. It was one of the building blocks of real democracy. Mm-hmm. And I remember every time someone talks about that, I remember the famous statement made by Winston Churchill in the House of Commons, a speech he made on November 11 of 1947, and this was... These are his words, which the usual way it's quoted is slightly different than what he said here, but what he said was, democracy is the worst form of government, except for all those other forms that have been tried from time to time.
It's capitalism, too.
Yeah. Well, certainly Paul was suggesting that we need to respect government. We need to pay our taxes. We need to recognize that they exert power and that they can exercise it within certain limits. There were certainly pressures and brutality used in the Roman Empire in Paul's day. He wasn't trying to suggest that everybody in the Roman Empire was perfect, I'm sure of that. Well, let's take our best example of all. Did Jesus ever exercise any civil disobedience?
Yes.
Yes?
That's why I love Jesus.
Because he exercised his civil disobedience?
Yeah, he tells the truth when he needs to.
Okay, think of some examples of Jesus' civil disobedience.
Well, about as close as he got was cleaning out the temple traders and throwing their tables and money all over the place.
Yeah, and what was going on in that courtyard? Remember, this is the area that was supposed to be for Gentiles to come and worship and to learn about the Jewish religion. And what had they done with it?
The stock exchange out of it.
They made it a money-changing place, a place for selling cattle and sheep and goats and lambs and pigeons and so forth at very, very exalted prices. It was a pure scam to keep the wealthy wealthy and the poor poor.
Some years ago down in Florida, time of the Passover, they had a shortage on matzah bread.
Mm.
And so they jacked the price up appropriately because... So it's a long history of taking advantage of situation.
Do you think if Jesus came to a church right now, he would feel the same way that he felt in that temple when he see what's going on in some churches now?
Oh, I'm sure that's...
Well, hopefully we're not actually operating a stock exchange or carrying animals in to be sold at exalted prices. But I'm sure he would have things to say about other things that were going on. Yeah. Well, here's a comment from Ellen White that I think we need to take seriously. The people of God will recognize human government as an ordinance of divine appointment and will teach obedience to it as a sacred duty within its legitimate sphere. But when its claims conflict with the claims of God, the Word of God must be recognized as above all human legislation. Thus saith the Lord is not to be set aside for thus saith the church or the state. The crown of Christ is to be uplifted above the diadems of earthly potentates. Page 402, paragraph 1 of volume 6 of the Testimonies. Well, let me take one of my favorite parts of Scripture. For a variety of reasons, but partly because it's a very pointed discussion between Jesus and the Sanhedrin. It starts in John chapter 8 and verse 12. And we obviously don't have time to read all this, but Jesus spoke to the Pharisees again. I am the light of the world, he said. Whoever follows me will have the light of life and will never walk in darkness. The Pharisees said to him, now you're testifying on your own behalf. What you say proves nothing. And of course, they said that because of what? According to the Jewish system, how many people do you have to testify to something?
Two.
At least two, preferably three. Okay? And so he goes on to claim that his father is witnessing for him, and so he and his father are two witnesses. And of course, then it turns to verse 19, where is your father? They asked him. You know neither me nor my father, Jesus answered. If you knew me, you would know my father also. Jesus said all this as he taught in the temple in the room where the offering boxes were placed, and no one arrested him because his hour had not come. It's very interesting that the offering boxes in the temple, here's a little trivia question for you. The offering boxes in the temple, where do you think they were placed? Think about what you know about this layout of the temple. Where do you suppose the offering boxes were placed?
Probably right there to the entrance to the temple itself, I would assume.
Well, yeah, the problem is that there was too much stuff going on there with even where other people coming in and out and so forth. It was what?
Where everybody could see. It had to have been where everybody could see who was putting what.
It was in the court of the women. Why would it be in the court of the women?
The women could donate.
Yes, of course. The men could pass through the court of the women, but the women could not go into the court of the men. So you have to have the offering boxes in the court of the women.
Oh, goodness.
And I wouldn't be surprised if they were the ones that gave the most, too. Because even with Jesus, mm-hmm. Who supported him with the women, rich women.
Let's hope that it was the intent to put money in the money box is why the men went there and not for other reasons.
Yeah.
Well, they had to pass through the court of women to get where they were supposed to go.
Well, I was thinking maybe they were attracted to the ladies too.
Well, that's also possible. Again, Jesus said to them, now he's speaking to the Pharisees in the temple, I will go away, you will look for me, but you will die in your sins. You cannot go where I'm going. So the Jewish authorities said, he says that we cannot go where he is going. Does that mean that he will kill himself? Jesus answered, you belong to this world here below, but I come from above. You're from this world, but I am not from this world. That is why I told you that you will die in your sins, and you will die in your sins if you do not believe that I am who I am.
Did Jesus think that they understood him? Did he even expect that they would be able to understand that kind of talk?
I suspect there's a lot more to this conversation than what we have recorded here.
Oh.
And I would certainly have thought, I mean, when he says, I am who I am, what, of course, he's speaking Aramaic. He's not speaking Greek. Greek is the language we have recorded. We've got it here translated into English. But when he says, I am who I am, what does that go back to?
God saying,
burning.
That's the personal name of God.
I am.
I am God. And who are you? They asked him. I mean, you know, Jesus answered, what I have told you from the very beginning. I have much to say about you, much to condemn you for. The one who sent me, however, is truthful, and I tell the world only what I have heard from him. They did not understand that Jesus was talking to them about the Father. So he said to them, When you lift up the Son of Man, you will know that I am who I am. What is he saying again?
He's God.
He's God. Then you will know that I do nothing on my own authority, but I say only what the Father has instructed me to do, to say. And he goes on. We don't have time to read the whole thing until we get down. It gets very interesting. We get down to verse 38. I talk about what my Father has shown me, but you do what your Father has told you. They answered, our Father is Abraham. If you really were Abraham's children, Jesus replied, you would do the same things that he did. All I have ever done is to tell you the truth. I heard from God, yet you're trying to kill me. Abraham did nothing like this. You are doing what your father did. And of course,
your father the devil, wasn't it?
God himself is the only father we have, they answered. We are his true children. And what's Jesus' response? Jesus said to them, if God really were your father, you would love me because I came from God and now I am here. I did not come on my own authority, but he sent me. I mean, you know, this is just about as pointed and as just
now
in your face talk as you can imagine.
The Jewish people knew from prophecy that the Messiah should be there at about that time. So when Jesus said he was the Messiah, they didn't check it out. They sort of rejected Jesus before they even...
But he came from Nazareth. He's a Galilean. He didn't go to any of our schools. How could he possibly be the Messiah?
They did check him out, and he didn't fit what they thought the Messiah should be.
Then he goes on, why do you not understand what I say? He said twice already, what? I am God. It is because you cannot bear to listen to my message. They couldn't hear it because it was so contrary to what they believed. It is because you are the children of your father, the devil, and you want to follow your father's desires. From the very beginning, he was a murderer, and he has never been on the side of truth because there is no truth in him. I mean, boy, these are just... Well, finally, we drop down to verse 52. They said to him, now we are certain that you have a demon. Abraham died in the... we need to read 49. I have no demon, Jesus answered. I honor my father, but you dishonor me. I am not seeking honor for myself, but there is one who is seeking it and who judges in my favor. I am telling you the truth. Whoever obeys my teaching will never die. They said to him, now we are certain that you have a demon. Abraham died, the prophets died, yet you say that whoever obeys your teaching will never die? Our father Abraham died. You do not claim to be greater than Abraham, do you? He didn't say, yes, I do. He said, and the prophets also died. Who do you think you are? Jesus answered, if I were to honor myself, that honor would be worth nothing. The one who honors me is my father, the very one you say is your God. I mean, you know, how can you be plainer than that? You have never known me, but I know him. I'm sorry, you have never known him, but I have known him. But I know him. If I were to say that I do not know him, I would be a liar like you. But I do know him, and I obey his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced that he was to see the time of my coming. He saw it and was glad. They said to him, you're not even 50 years old, and you've seen Abraham? I'm telling you the truth, Jesus replied. And you know, he says it now in a way they can't possibly mistake what he's saying. Before Abraham was born, I am. Then they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and left the temple. Now that's the ultimate example of his relating to authority, religious authority.
Now that's the way we should go discipling
Absolutely.
Those people in authority.
So Jesus was healing the sick, raising the dead,
and condemning the Sanhedrin.
And condemning the Sanhedrin, and the Sanhedrin would not say, wait a minute, let's think a little deeper about this. They just picked up stones to stone Jesus.
But we would have the right to say what Jesus did if their salvation depended upon us, right?
Well, his arguments there were pretty out of the ordinary. I mean, they were looking for things to grab onto so he could start arguing with them. But it was too high. It was too deep into the, you know, his explanation to be able to do that. And when they started saying, well, we know you're from the devil now, they were just picking out these little tiny things. Yeah. And he couldn't see, they couldn't do any more than that, you know? Mm-hmm. But yet, you know, he just kept pouring it on like it was a one-way thing, you know, which was pretty incredible.
Okay, let's take another example. Now, I wish we had time, I wish we had an hour or two or three or four to talk about this, but we know, starting from John 2, that almost from the very beginning of his ministry, the Pharisees were determined to kill him. They were looking for an opportunity to discredit him before in the eyes of the people, and then based on that, they were going to arrest him, and they were going to do him in. They were determined, almost his entire ministry, that's what they were trying to do. So here's Jesus. This is Mark 2, starting with verse 23. Jesus was walking through some cornfields on the Sabbath. As his disciples walked along with him, they began to pick the ears of corn. So the Pharisees said to Jesus, "Look, it is against our law for your disciples to do that on the Sabbath." It is against whose law?
Our law.
Jesus answered, "Have you never read what David did that time when he needed something to eat? He and his men were hungry, so he went into the house of God and ate the bread offered to God." Which isn't exactly true. What actually happened?
Now, wait a minute. Are you saying Jesus is saying something that's not exactly true here?
I'm saying that Jesus, at least the way it's reported to us.
Well, they're going to jerk us off the air here.
I'm just asking you to remember what actually happened. What really happened? He asked the high priest, and the high priest brought the bread out to them, didn't he?
He asked permission.
Yeah. And the high priest, but he did not go into the sanctuary to get the bread. He stood outside, the high priest brought it to him, okay? This happened when Abiathar was the high priest. According to our law, only the priests may eat this bread, but David ate it and even gave it to his men. And Jesus concluded, the Sabbath was made for the good of human beings. They were not made for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath. Now, what are we supposed to learn from that? I always have been puzzled when he told this story. I couldn't quite figure out why he said that.
I understood it. Because I don't think the Sabbath should be a yoke around people's neck. Mm-hmm. Because you lose, you know, the essence of what it's supposed to be.
But what does that have to do with David eating the showbread?
Well, he was in need.
Yeah.
And he ate.
And that's one of the things. That's one of the simple lessons. You know, we need to meet people's needs. Mm-hmm. You know, we should meet people's needs even on the Sabbath.
Yes.
Okay, that's one simple lesson. But what beyond that?
Put common sense into the Sabbath.
Okay. Jay, you were going to say something.
Well, these are both sacred things that he's dealing with.
Yeah.
That's yes. What I was going to say.
Okay.
They were splitting hairs. I mean, it's been many generations ago when they had a more correct vision of the possibility of a Messiah. Right now, it was legalities. We've got this cornered. This is our boat. Don't rock it. Mm-hmm. This is basically all they were interested in.
Yeah. Is that all the priest had to eat? Was that bread?
No,
he
no.
He didn't
no,
have
no,
some
no,
other. Why didn't he ask? Why didn't he ask the priest for some other thing?
Good question. We don't know.
Do you have any lambs or?
Yeah. Well, but there's something else going on here that I just found out fairly recently. David, what was David's position when he asked for the bread or when he went to the temple?
David had been an anointed king, but he had not taken the throne.
Right. He was an anointed king, but he had not yet been enthroned.
Just as Jesus.
An anointed person is called a what?
Messiah.
That's what anointed means. Messiah means anointed, okay? And Jesus is saying, someone else is here who has also been anointed by God himself at the time of his baptism, but he has not yet been enthroned. So here is a direct parallel between the story of David and the story of Jesus. And what did the priests do to help David in those days? They gave him the showbread, right? At the risk of their own lives, because what happened later?
85
of them were killed. Because Saul discovered that they had actually helped David, and he was very upset about it. So they helped the Messiah, the anointed one, against the government. And now what's happening with the Sanhedrin? Yes?
Did Saul understand this relationship of that David was anointed and not yet on the throne, and that's why the priests gave him the allegiance of giving him the showbread?
Yes.
Is that why he killed 85?
But it's pretty clear.
Okay.
Yeah. So Jesus is saying, if you were looking back to King David as your leader, what should you be doing? You should be respecting and supporting someone, a future king who has been anointed Messiah, right? Okay, let's take another story. Look at Mark 3, 1 to 6, moving right along here. Mark 3, 1 to 6. Then Jesus went back to the synagogue where there was a man who had a paralyzed hand. Sometimes it's called a withered hand. Some people were there who wanted to accuse Jesus of doing wrong. So they watched him closely. Some people who wanted to accuse Jesus of doing wrong. I wonder who that would be.
Is that the Pharisees?
Of course. Yeah. So they watched him closely to see whether he would heal the man on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man, come up here to the front. Now, could anyone accuse him of breaking the Sabbath by saying to somebody, come to the front? Is that a violation of any Sabbath rule?
No.
No. Okay. Then he asked the people, what does our law allow us to do on the Sabbath, to help or to harm, to save someone's life or to destroy it? And what did they say?
They did not say a thing.
There's not a thing they could say because the answer was obvious, but it's not what they wanted, right? How often do we keep quiet when we know what we should do, but we don't like it?
But I think also they would have gone out and got their donkey out of a bog if they had to.
Exactly.
They'd do it to that, but not anything else contravened.
But Carrie, you have to recognize if your donkey's in a bog, that's an emergency situation.
Right.
This man's hand has been like this for years.
But it kind of goes back to what you were just talking about earlier. They were so legalistic, they lost the whole picture.
Yeah.
There's another thing, but they did not say a thing. It could be that the humble people were afraid to say anything because the Pharisees would not like what their answer was. And a lot of times we don't say something because someone won't like our answer.
Yep.
I was just comparing the different versions of the different Gospels on that. And Matthew says the same, some people, but Luke says some teachers of the law and some Pharisees wanted a reason to accuse Jesus of doing wrong.
Yep.
So they watched him closely to see if he would heal on the Sabbath.
Exactly.
So,
and right there, their
support.
Name.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So Jesus was angry. Now that's Mark. Now, what do we know about the Gospel of Mark? Who wrote it and why it was written?
Peter wrote it.
Okay.
Well, Peter's gospel was Mark.
Mark is actually Peter's gospel. It was written by Mark, but the experiences were those of Peter. And there's considerable evidence for that. It was almost certainly the first gospel written. And Peter tells it, you know how Peter was. He was, you know, just, he was impelled. He would just jump in. He would say what he wanted to say. And the gospel of Mark is all like that. Yeah. And here
so
he says.
So Mark was just taking down what Peter said and he could write
it. He says, Jesus was angry. Matthew and Luke don't say anything about Jesus being angry as he looked around at them. But at the same time, he felt sorry for them because they were so stubborn and wrong. Then he said to the man, stretch out your hand. Now, is there anything wrong with telling somebody to stretch out their hand?
No.
Even if they can't move it?
Oh.
He stretched it out and became well again. So the Pharisees left the synagogue and met at once with some members of Herod's party, and they made plans to kill Jesus. Now I don't know how many times they've already made plans to kill Jesus, but this is another one. Now, what's the normal relationship between Herod's party and Jesus and the Pharisees?
Don't they usually hate each other?
They hated each other.
Exactly, friends.
Yeah. But here they are. We have the left and the right cooperating to try to destroy Jesus.
So this action on the part of Jesus here is a good way to disciple these people?
Well, I mean, this is the question. We're looking at some stories, and then we're going to try to draw some conclusions. What do you do when you know, when there's some good to be done, and you know how to do it, you can do it, you have the ability to do it, but there's people in authority who don't want you to do it. What do you do then?
half the people will do it and the other half won't do it.
Well, you go ahead and do what your conscience tells you to do and they chop your head off.
Yeah. Yep. Okay, turn now to Luke 7. Here's a very interesting story. When Jesus had finished saying all these things to the people, he went to Capernaum. A Roman officer there had a servant who was very dear to him. Now, my version says a Roman officer. What's he called in the traditional translations?
Centurion.
A centurion. What's a centurion?
Over 1,000, wasn't he?
He's over at least 100 and up to 1,000, yeah. So this guy's a man who's got authority, okay? And he's living in what is effectively Jesus' hometown, right? So this is probably the big boss in that area, as far as the Roman government is concerned, right? When the officer heard about Jesus, he sent some Jewish elders to ask him to come and heal his servant. Now, what's going on here?
Well, two things. The centurion valued his servant, mm-hmm. and he obviously had heard of Christ, and he realized that there was something special about him, and on the other hand, he had faith that Christ would do something, and he sent his servant.
But there's a couple things we're overlooking here. Was Jesus supposed to go to the centurion's house?
No.
According to Jewish custom?
Probably not.
No! He wasn't allowed to go into that centurion's house. So the centurion has asked the religious leaders because he has actually helped them to build a synagogue. And so they are indebted to him. And so he says, well, I can't ask him to come to my house. I'm a Roman. You know, he's not going to want to come to my house. He's a rabbi. But you can talk to him. And what happened? They went and talked to him, and Jesus said, okay. So he started off, and where is he headed? He's headed for the centurion's house, right? And what happened finally?
The centurion ran out to meet Jesus?
Yeah, he went out. He says, you don't need to come to my house. He says, what he's really saying is, I'm not asking you to break your Jewish custom.
Yeah, I don't want to get you in trouble.
I don't want to get you in trouble. Just say the word. I'm sure that, I mean, this was in a day when there was no radios, there was no cell phones, there was no television. The idea that you could say something here and have an effect over there was unthinkable to them.
But he had been watching Jesus with an open heart and mm-hmm. knew.
Now, I didn't quite get that when I read that way. Mm-hmm. Because at the end, Jesus was mortified at his faith.
Not mortified.
Well,
he thought it was wonderful.
I know, but still, well, so wonderful. He's
surprised.
He was surprised. Now, if he was just going out there to protect him, don't come into my place. Oh. That to me would be less faith right there. But if he came out and he knew that Jesus was like a person, a ruler over many people, like he was, mm-hmm. he would really have faith in saying that and believing that.
Well, I
and that would be the reason I'd think yeah. why he didn't want him to come. He wanted him to just make it happen.
I see a combination of what you said and what I said. I think he was trying to protect Jesus, number one. I think he recognized that nobody but Jesus was going to be able to help his servant. I think that's pretty clear to everybody. I think he also recognized that this Jesus has unusual powers, and Jesus, I think, was amazed by the fact that he said, all you have to do is just say the word.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if Christ had heard of this man, because a little lower down, and I'd never noticed this yeah. before, the people that came pleading with him to come and see the servant said, he loves our nation and he is the one who built us our synagogue. In yeah. other words, he kept the soldiers working and the contractors.
Yeah,
I have been known.
Yeah.
You know, there's a couple of stories missing here in our...
Yes.
What about John the Baptist when yeah. he went to disciple, was it Herod?
Yes.
And, you know, how did he know to go there? And I've often thought that he shouldn't have gone there. He was overstepping his bounds a little mm-hmm. bit. How did he, was he supposed to be there? I mean, the consequences of that, it appears to me, shortened his ministry.
Well, so, and this is the question now. And you point out a very good question that should be in here somewhere, and that's, if we are faced with people of power, religious authority, political authority, even military authority, do we keep quiet when we know they're doing something they shouldn't be doing?
Well, but there's little things and there's big things. How do you know when to make a big thing out of a little thing? How do you know?
I guess it's how you present it. I mean, the way John did it was...
There's bad going on...
Everywhere.
Everywhere. So how do you know... I mean, if I went up to the conference office and protested things up there that I think that are not good, and down over at my local, over at the board church board and at the school board, and, you know, I wouldn't have time to go to work.
Yeah, that's true.
So how do you know who you're supposed to be discipling?
It's very interesting, talking about discipling the powerful now, it's very interesting that there's another centurion in Acts 10. And what happened with him? Cornelius?
Is he at the foot of the cross?
No, Cornelius. Okay. Cornelius, the one Peter went up and preached to him at his house.
He was told by the Holy Spirit, send a man to Peter, have him come to your house.
And so what we see here is, here are two very powerful Roman military officers who have already taken a very serious interest in the Jewish religion. No Jew went to preach to them. No Christian went to preach to them. They came to the Christians to ask for help with the little prompting from the Holy Spirit.
They came to the Jewish people to ask for help.
No,
Jesus or Peter.
Oh, and the Christians.
The guy in Capernaum asked the Jewish leaders, because they thought they would be the one who would have influence, to come to Jesus. But both of these people said, you know, we know something about your religion. This guy has helped build a synagogue. The other guy has become a worshiper, a follower of the way. And both of them reach out into the church and say, please come and teach us, basically. Do something for us.
Is that saying that as a church, we can be so tied up in ourselves, but the people on the outside are watching us and making evaluations and deciding?
And we're not even paying enough attention to say, come on in.
Yeah, yeah.
So you're talking about the powerful people here, but there's one thing that those two have in common. Mm-hmm. They all needed something.
Yeah.
And there was what they needed
Cornelius
was completely out of their power to get it.
No. Cornelius didn't really need anything.
He didn't need anything?
What did he need? He said, I have received a vision from God. I'm told that I need to call a man by the name of Peter. So he sends his guys down there. He's got plenty of soldiers. He sends his guys down there and says, Peter, I am told that you're supposed to come to my house and preach to us.
Okay, put that one aside. Go to the other one.
Okay,
that one, he really needed somebody.
Yeah.
Okay, so if we have powerful people, they're going to have to need something for us to help them out.
No, the centurion at the foot of the cross didn't need anything, and he says, this must be the Son of
still,
God.
Still, I'm trying
but
to
I mean,
make
now
a point
there's
here.
Two examples you're I'm throwing
still
out.
Making, I'm still making a point here that when you have powerful people, and they don't need anything from you, they'll just walk right over you.
Yeah, often that's
So, you know, how do you deal with that?
What I would draw from this is the lesson here is is that these people are coming, in these cases, to Jesus. So there was a life here that was being lived that was witnessing, and they were attracted to the witness.
Exactly. Something out there, we don't know the whole story, but something out there they saw as attractive.
There are powerful people who will run over you, and other powerful people who are thoughtfully watching and have open minds, and they're figuring things out.
Okay, so which one of those are we talking about when we're talking about the powerful people here?
We don't know. We don't know how God is working with that powerful person.
Yeah.
So in regards to powerful people, we're supposed to be a passive.
No,
we're not supposed to get aggressive in
we're supposed
discipling
to stand up and
these
say, we have the truth, and all you poor people out there don't have the truth.
No, we're supposed to live the truth.
The lesson here is we're dealing with offices of the then-known local government, and you have to be diplomatic, but you can be firm. Mm-hmm. Now, if they've got a sword in your tummy, did you steal so-and-so? No, I didn't. Then you're fending for yourself, and you still should still be honest.
Mm-hmm.
And the opposite of what can get out of hand is when powerful people start to
abuse their power.
Hence, we have all these people down through the dark ages that were killed. And if you want to look at it more locally, look what happened to Dietrich Bonhoeffer in World War II with Hitler. That was mentioned when we first opened. He stood his ground and paid his life.
Yeah. So let's think about this for a moment. Are there people out there, powerful people, military people, political people, who are looking for something?
Yes. Didn't Ellen White say in the time of trouble that there will be a few leaders in our government that will be holding back the tide? And, you know, they have come to know the Adventists or the Christians and are making decisions on what they've seen in our lives.
So is there some way to identify those people who are really looking for something out there? I mean, those would be the right people for us to work on, right?
They might come and ask a question. Mm-hmm. Whoever comes and asks a question.
That would be a good clue.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, one of the most troublesome exchanges, or interchanges, if you like, recorded in the Gospels, of course, was Jesus when he was on trial. And what happened, we could spend hours on this, but basically what happened in those, remember he went to Annas, he went to Caiaphas, he went to Pilate, and then he went to the full Sanhedrin, then he went to Pilate, then he went to Herod, then went back to Pilate. What happened during all of those, what was going on during all that time? Was Jesus trying to convert them?
He didn't say much.
He didn't say much. What are we supposed to learn from that?
Was he saying, who's going to stand up for me and who isn't?
When Jesus was what?
Well, he was on trial. Basically, he said almost nothing, unless he was sort of, you know, I swear, you know, I command you to swear by the living God, are you the Messiah, da-da, whatever. When they would actually put a straight thing to him, like, in the name of the Father or something, like, then he would speak. Otherwise, he kept quiet.
Well, his purpose was not to win arguments at that time, was it?
That's what I'm asking.
I don't think it was.
What was he trying to do?
It was to go through with his father what he was to go through. Mm-hmm. That he was prophesying that he would go through. Mm-hmm. And if he was there to win an argument, well, then he would have done it.
It's in one sense, he let them hang themselves.
Without a question, he could have spoken up and rebutted just about everything that was going on there.
He could have struck them dead.
Technically, it was illegal how they were doing it anyway. Yes. He knew it, and they probably did too, mm-hmm. but didn't care.
Was he being submissive to the forces of evil in the world that his father said, you have to be, this is the cup you have to drink, and Jesus was experiencing pure sin?
Well, the lesson here is talking about discipling the powerful.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I would like you to think, and maybe answer this question. Were there some of the people who were there who actually decided to become followers of Jesus while that was going on?
I think so.
Yes.
Well, maybe more after things
Well,
happened.
I mean, they didn't obviously stand up for Jesus right then.
What they
but
saw.
Did they saw, did they see or hear something that led to their conversion later?
Right. Yes.
What we read early on in Acts 6:7 and 15:5,
yeah.
About the Pharisees and the priests.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. So there were people being, they could see. They're looking at Caiaphas, they're looking at Annas, they're looking at Pilate, they're looking at Herod, and here's Jesus. And what are they seeing?
He has done no wrong. He's mm-hmm. only spoke the truth. And they're seeing corruption all around him.
And he's calm.
Integrity versus lack of integrity.
Absolutely. And they're going berserk trying to find some accusations against him, and he's standing there looking royal. You know? Wow. Well, if someone had done a poll, or go ahead.
Was that the ultimate of civil disobedience?
Good question. I don't know if he'd call
it. You mean to remain silent?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
No, he made the one or two salient answers that he should have. But if he'd have really argued, he could have looked like a backwoods lawyer, which wouldn't have been a good impression either.
Well, think about the one little bit longer statement that he made in that whole thing that's recorded. There may have been other things right. said that we don't have recorded, but he said, I could have called a whole lot of angels, yes. and not only that, but one day I'm going to be the judge and you're going to be on trial before me. And what would you think if you were at least half unbiased, if you heard something like that and you saw the two sides in their behavior, what would you say? I think there's a lot of people who did some serious thinking. In fact, Ellen White goes on to say, after that happened, and then there was the darkness while he was on the cross, and then there was an earthquake, and then he was buried. And she says, there were people who didn't sleep from that moment until they found out he had been raised from the dead. They were studying their Bibles. They were exploring, could this possibly be yes. the Messiah we have been looking for?
Exactly.
So there were a lot of people who saw something that may not be completely obvious to us from the very brief accounts that we have recorded, but they saw some things that made a powerful impression on them, and many of them became Christians later.
A big thing that we could see now is that how many bad things can you do to God before he will not forgive you anymore?
Yeah.
I mean, you couldn't do anything more to a person yeah. than what they did to Jesus, and yet he still did not come up and condemn people.
If you were doing an evaluation of the Christian church at the point where Jesus is dead, would you say it had become very successful?
No.
Say that again.
If you were to say, okay, I'm here to see how successful Jesus has been, what's happened to this nascent Christian church, at the point where Jesus is dead, what would you say?
It's on the point
where
of extinction.
Where he's in the yeah. grave.
Point of distinction.
Extinction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Extinction. Extinction. That's what I tried to say. I said, did I say distinction?
Yeah. I was going to say barely in its infancy.
Barely in its infancy.
but in reality, right? On the point of distinction.
Yes. Yeah. 50 days later, what happened?
Pentecost.
Now, I have a question. Mm-hmm. We're talking about powerful people in discipleship. Did Christ go out and say, you're going to be a really powerful person, and so I'm going to go for you mm-hmm. and do
that's what Paul
be
was
kind and okay mm-hmm. or was he sure. the same to everybody?
Well, he didn't say it to everybody, you are of your father the devil.
Well, no.
So he didn't treat everybody exactly the same.
Well, wasn't that because those people deserved that? I mean, yeah. if anybody would have done that, they would have been deserving of that too.
Yeah.
Didn't so. Jesus have a hard time with powerful people, like what was the rich young ruler? Mm-hmm. Jesus tried to talk to him, but...
Our Bible study suggests that there were a lot of people sitting on the fence, and Jesus knocked out the fence. He had to come down one yeah. side or the other.
But I think he treated all levels the same. Mm-hmm. He had no, I mean, apart from that says he loved John, but there were no favorites elsewhere as far as we know. There's none mentioned. Mm-hmm.
So did he not give those Pharisees and the Sadducees the same opportunity at the beginning?
Yeah.
They chose, they made their choice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So when we present to, or when we are living our lives out there, are we going to be better for this person over here to see that we're being a good example for Christ rather than, well, he's going to be a goner anyway, so we don't have to worry about him.
There's only a couple of the apostles whose stories are reported in fairly considerable detail. The one who's reported by far the most detail, of course, is Paul. And this is what he said about his relationship to the government. And I'm looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 11, and we only have a couple of minutes left here. But if anyone dares to boast about something, I'm talking like a fool, I will be just as daring. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they Abraham's descendants? So am I. Are they Christ's servants? I sound like a madman, but I'm a better I am a better servant than they are. I have worked much harder. I have been in prison more times. I have been whipped much more. And I have been near death more often. 5 times I was given the 39 lashes by the Jews. What did they want to do to him? This is a former member of the Sanhedrin. 3 times I was whipped by the Romans. And these whippings were considered to be basically deadly. And once I was stoned, I have been in 3 shipwrecks, and once I spent 24 hours in the water. In my many travels, I have been in danger from the floods and from the robbers, in danger from fellow Jews and from Gentiles. There have been dangers in the cities, dangers in the wild, and he goes on. So how good was he doing at influencing the powerful?
He was trying.
He was trying.
Well, the powerful might be amazed at how he always, he was like a cat with more than 9 lives. He always came back.
Yeah. Well, in the brief,
it would be assumed from the title, Discipling the Powerful, that there's implied that there's a different way to disciple the powerful than there is the not so powerful. So what's the difference here?
Okay, I'm now going to read to you from Ministry of Healing. This will give us a clue. It is by no casual accidental touch that wealthy, world-loving, world-worshipping souls can be drawn to Christ. These persons are often the most difficult of access. Personal efforts must be put forth for them by men and women imbued with the missionary spirit, those who will not fail or be discouraged. You never give up, she's saying. Some are especially fitted to work for the higher classes. Ministry of Healing, page 213, paragraphs 3 and 4. So, basically, he says some of these people are going to be really hard to leave, but to access, but do not give up. So that's at least a clue, right? Well, what kind of a reputation does your church have in your community? If a group of the leading citizens of your community came to your church and said, "We want to see Jesus," what would you do? What would you say? Now, clearly, you're not going to influence them by a single encounter. Jesus couldn't influence people by a single encounter. Sometimes we have to speak things that are not altogether friendly, but we must not give up. We must try. In our day, there's all kinds of people who need to be influenced. We're throwing the challenge to you.